This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book My Confession by Leo Tolstoy. My Confession. 1. I was baptized and raised according to the principles of the Orthodox Christian Church. We taught them to me from my childhood, throughout my adolescence and my youth. But at 18, after a second year of university, I already no longer believed in anything I was taught. Some memories even suggest to me that I never seriously believed, and what I took to the faith that was professed confidence in that major. This trust itself was very shaky. I remember that when I was 11 or so, we had Sunday, visiting Volodinka M., a student died from gymnasium, which we announced as big news, a recent discovery made in the gym. This discovery was in that God did not exist, and that everything we were taught was that vain invention. That was in 1838. I remember how my older brothers became interested in this new, engaging me to join them. We are all extremely animames and recumes this news as something very fun and quite possible. I still remember that during his stay at the university, my older brother Dimitri gave himself suddenly to religion with the passion of his own. When he began to attend all services fasting, bring a pure and moral life, all of us, even older, we mukwames of him in the rewarding God knows why, the nickname of Noah. I still remember that Mr. Mason Pushkin, then rector of the University of Kazan, sometimes invited us to dance, and like my brother refused his invitation, he wanted to decide the saying, ironically, that David had also danced before the ark. I was chorus then these jokes for seniors, and I pulled the conclusion that he had to learn the catechism and go to church, but that we should not take it all too seriously. I also remember that as a young man I read Voltaire, and his mockery, far from rebelling, amused me. My abandonment of faith did as that happened, and still happens to people of our world. It seems to me that this happens in most cases as well. Men live lives like everyone else, and everyone bases his life on principles that not only have nothing to do with religion, but most often are completely opposed to it. Teaching religion has no effect on life. He did rule, in any way, our relationships with other men, and in our own existence, it never happens that we visit. This teaching finds application there, somewhere, far from life and independently of it. If one is in contact with him, it's like with any external phenomenon, which is not at all related to life. By the life of man, by his actions, then as now, it is impossible to know whether he believes it or not. If there is a difference between one who publicly professes orthodoxy and one who denies it, it is not in favor of the former. Then as now, the confession and the ostensible practice of orthodoxy meet in most cases in bounded people, cruel, immoral, and thinking of great importance, while the intelligence, honesty, openness, kindness, and morality are usually found among men who say they are unbelievers. We teach catechism in schools and send students to the church. It requires communion certificates of government employees. But the man of our society, who learns more and who is not in government service and now wants more, can live for years and years without remembering once he saw among Christians, and that itself is considered practicing Orthodox Christian religion. Then, as now, which was admitted without examination and maintained by pressure, melts under the influence of knowledge and experience of life, which are contrary to religion. And yet man lives, often very long, imagining that faith in which he was educated in his childhood, full lives in it, while there are over-long traces. S., a frank and spiritual man told me how he stopped believing. He was 26 years, when one day hunting, in the hour of rest, he began to pray in a childhood habit. His brother, who was hunting with him, was lying on the hay and watched. S., when he finished his prayer and prepared to set, his brother said, "And you do it again now?" And they said nothing more. But S. only begged more since that day, and 30 years ago, that he does not pray, do not commune, and not going to church. And this, not because he knows the convictions of his brother and he adopted them, not because he has decided something in his soul, but only because the word spoken by his brother was like the gentle push of the finger on a wall about to fall, driven as it is by its own weight. This speech did nothing but show him where he supposed religion resided, was an empty place for a long time, and so the words he said, crosses and bows he made during his prayer, were only actions without the slightest sense. Having seized their absurdity, he could not continue. This is how it happens, and it happened, I think, for most people of our education. I speak sincere men to themselves, not those who make religion a means of achieving any goal ephemeral. Those people are the genuine atheists, because if religion is for them a means to some worldly goal, is of course not the conviction that leads. It is as if these men had felt the light of knowledge and life melt this artificial edifice. They are already perceived or have not yet opened his eyes. Religious instruction I had received from my childhood disappeared in me in the same way as in others, with the only difference that as I started to read books of philosophy since the age of 15, C is discerning, and very early, I abjured my faith first. From the age of 16 I prayed over and I no longer went to church and did not my devotions, and in this I was following my own pulse. I did not believe what had me taught since childhood, but I believed in something. What? I could not say with precision. I believed in God, or rather I do not fool God, but what God? I'm not stupid either Christ or his teachings, but how this teaching he was. Today, remembering this time, I see clearly that my religion was this something which, apart from the purely animal instinct, was guiding my life. My only, my true belief in that time, was my faith in development. But what constituted development, and what was its purpose? I could not tell. I tried to improve myself spiritually. I learned everything I could about the horizons that opened my life. I tried to develop my will. I composed the rules that I tried to follow. I perfectioned me physically by all kinds of exercises, cultivating my strength and my address, and getting used to fatigue and patience by all kinds of privations. All these reforms, I took them to the development. The beginning of all was certainly the moral improvement, but it soon turned into general development, that is to say, desire to be better, not in my own eyes or those of God, but desire to be better in the eyes of other men. And soon this trend changed in desire to be stronger than other men, that is to say, more famous and richer than others. 2. I will tell one day the story of my life that was touching and instructive during these 10 years of my youth. I wanted with all my heart to be good, but I was young, I had passions, and I was alone, completely alone when I was looking good. Every time I tried to speak to the ardent desire I had to be morally good, I met contempt and ridicule. But when I devoted myself to vile passions, they praised me, they encouraged me. Ambition, passion for power, greed, lust, pride, anger, revenge, all this was said. I engaged in these passions, I began to look like a man, and I felt that we were pleased with me. My good aunt, with whom I lived and was well be the purest in the world, always told me that she desired nothing so much for me that a liaison with a married woman. No, as a young man, as a liaison with a woman properly, she said. She still wanted another happiness for me, that of being aide, and especially the emperor aide, and as height of felicity, that I manasseh to a young rich girl, and I had, as a result of this marriage, the most possible serfs. I cannot without terror, without disgust, and without suffering of the soul, remember those years. I killed men in war, I defied the duel to kill, I lost the game, I dissipi the product of the work of the peasants, I was punishing them, I was doing crazy things, I was wrong. Lying, stealing, pleasures of all kinds, drunkenness, violence, murder. There is no crime that I have committed, and for all this was praised me, there were me and count me among relatively moral men. I lived thus 10 years. However, I began to write vanity, greed, and pride. I conformed my writings in my life. For the glory and the money for which I was writing, he had to hide the good and evil show. That's what I did. How many times have I contrived to hide in my writings, under the guise of indifference and a slight mockery, even these aspirations, well, which were the goal of my life. I succeeded and was praised me. At 26, I came to Petersburg after the war, and I became acquainted with writers who received me as one of them. It flattered me, and I had not the time to think that the views on life, any special views to the cast of people with whom I made friends, took hold of me, and soon faded completely all my previous efforts to become better. These opinions were based on a theory that excused all the debauchery of my life. The judgment that my letters were companions on life was in that life in general, walking progressing, and that in this development we take the main part, we men of thought. The preponderant influence belongs to us, artists and poets. Our mission is to educate men. And to this natural question, what am I and what do I teach, do not might present itself, it was explained, in this theory, there was no need to know this, and the artist or poet teach without knowledge. I was considered a great artist, a great poet, and therefore, I was very natural to me appropriate that theory. Me, the artist, the poet, I wrote, I was teaching, I did not know what myself. They paid me for it, I had everything, beautiful table, housing, women, society, I had glory. And therefore, what I was teaching was very good. This belief in the importance of poetry and the development of life was a religion, and I was one of his priests. Being one of his priests was very nice and very advantageous. And lived long enough in this belief, not doubting its truth. But in the second and especially the third year of such a life, I began to question the infallibility of that belief, and I began to study it. The first question pattern was as follows. I began to notice that the priests of our religion were not all agree with each other. Some said, we teach what it takes, and others do not teach the truth. And they talked, they argued, were rumbled, were mistaken, is abusing each other. There were also many men among us who did not care to know even who was right and who was wrong, not pursuing that purpose, to take advantage of our business. I was forced to doubt the truth of our beliefs. Now having doubted the truth of this literary religion, I began to observe more closely the priests, and I convinced myself that almost all were immoral men, and for the most evil men, insignificant, a character much more lower than that of men I had met in my military and debauched life. They were men content themselves, as may be the saints or those who do not even know what it is that holiness. I am disgusted with men, I am disgusted with myself, and I knew that this belief was a hoax. But the strange thing is that having understood everything quickly, and having denied lying, did not stop me under that gave me these men to artist, poet, and teacher. I imagined that I naively at least I were a poet, artist, and I could teach everyone, not knowing what I was teaching. And that's what I kept doing. My association with these men, I carried a new vice, a pride which developed until the disease crazy assurance believe me committed to teach men not knowing what to myself. Now when I remember that time, then my mood and character of these people, the rest there are millions like them today, I pity them. I am ashamed and I want to laugh at once, I feel that feeling that comes over us in the madhouse. We were convinced then that we needed to talk and talk endlessly, write and publish as quickly as possible and as much as possible, that it was necessary for the welfare of humanity. And thousands of us, while was growling and quibbling, were printing, writing, and claimed to instruct others. And not noticing that we knew nothing, that the question of the simplest life, what is good and what is bad? We did not know that answer. We were talking together, listening nothing, or sometimes admiring and praising the one or the other, provided to be praised and admired as. Other times we irritant against one another quite like crazy in an asylum. Thousands of workers were working day and night, and all their forces composed were printing thousands of words that spread position in the whole of Russia. And then we taught longer still without finding the time to teach everything, and we always fakians of what we do not listen enough. It is only now that I understand this strange time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.